This is the 12 Songs of Christmas. I'm Alex Rawls, and today I'm talking about Christmas cocktails with Brad Ross-MacLeod, one of the OG Christmas MP3 bloggers at falalalala.com. Christmas Cocktails Volumes 1 and 2 came out in 1996 and 1997 as part of Capitol Records' Ultra Lounge series. Ultra Lounge tried to strike while the lounge revival was hot, and Esquivel was king, mining the Capitol Records vaults for material from the 1950s and 60s that hit one of the many sweet spots that loosely fell under the lounge rubric. Crooners, certainly, but also groovy, swinging band leaders, faux Polynesian tracks, eleganza, and space-age pop. I'd only started collecting Christmas music 4 or 5 years before that first volume came out, and it gave me so much of what I was looking for from Christmas music. The songs had the kind of idiosyncrasy that I wanted from any music I liked, and I liked the way it gave me a Christmas musical past that I wasn't getting from the all-Christmas stations. The tracks were a window into a very different pop world than the one we lived in the late 1990s, but it was also unmistakably Christmas music. The songs on Christmas Cocktails compilations were undoubtedly part of our musical past, but it was a past that had been largely overlooked in favor of cooler, better-selling, or more consequential artists. As an indie guy, that had a strong allure. I'm not alone in my affection for the collections. They sold well enough that Capitol belatedly put out a Volume 3 in 2005, but it wasn't compiled by Brad Benedict, who collected the first two volumes, and the more pedestrian choices made it less essential. The success of the first two volumes led to Shout Factory Records releasing 3 volumes of the Wonderland series of Christmas albums in 2003, with the same creative team that had made the first two Christmas cocktails, including Brad Benedict. With a wider variety of record labels to choose from, it seemed like these should have topped Christmas cocktails. But the moment had passed, and while they're very good collections, they don't feel essential the way the first Christmas cocktails does. Today, I'm catching up with Brad Ross-MacLeod, who I first had on the podcast in 2021, and I'll put a link to that episode in the show notes. We'll talk about his blog, lounge, old music, and Christmas cocktails on the 12 Songs of Christmas. So to start with, what's the status of your blog right now?
It is circling the drain.
Oh, really?
There's a bunch of things going on. My blog really has never been an active part of the fa-la-la-la-la experience.
Right.
The forums have been, the interactive component has really been the driving piece of it, which has been fine for me. I like the community aspect. I like listening to others and discussions and whatnot. And so sort of my public face of, hey, here's this or whatever. And I've posted less and less over recent years.
Right.
And part of that is life stuff, you know, schedule and life and what I can do with that. And so it's kind of deprioritized. And I had sort of figured I was going to just quit it at the end of this year.
Oh, really?
I feel like I've said everything I need to say. I'm not as active a collector and participant as a lot of other folks. I've stopped buying vinyl. I sold my turntable, I think, a year or two ago. So much of the music that I got pulled into and my impetus at the beginning was all this stuff that had been not discovered, which is almost 20 years ago now. I wanted to get it out there, and 98% of it has found its way out there, and it's become rarer to sort of go through the vinyl racks and find something that's like, oh my God, this thing is fantastic. Everybody has to hear it. They pop up once in a while, but in my experience, other people have found it. You know, I think the pool of possible, again, recordings from, let's say, the 40s to the 60s, maybe 70s, that hasn't been found by anybody yet or really revived gets smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. What's seemed to become a boom in recent years has been international. I have a friend who has a blog on Japanese Christmas music, and he's found some amazing stuff in recent years. But I don't have sort of the mental bandwidth to jump into a whole new realm and try and figure out what's there and what's not there. And, you know, I guess I'm an old man.
Well,
and,
you know, I mean, I get that because, you know, I am sort of slowly accumulating more and more international, but part of the challenge is just straight up working out the aesthetics of it. Like when you find an old Firestone album, you already know the musical world that helped to create it. You know the showbiz world that helped to create it. And you know a lot of the musical touchstones that it's playing with. And, but I find I've got a song, a Japanese song, Koibito ga Santa Claus, My Boyfriend is Santa Claus. And I've now got about like 6 or 7 versions of it. And, you know, and it sounds pretty much, my favorite versions just kind of sound like they could be the soundtrack to a workout video in an 80s teen athletic sort of movie.
Well, and there's a lot of that in Japanese stuff. The stuff that counts as Christmas music in Japan, from what I've seen, is a little off the map as far as what's Christmas. Even I found that's true also if you look to the UK and the, you know, the Christmas, it just happens to be song that's number one the week of Christmas, and so you go through the history of like the Christmas number ones, like that's not a Christmas song, but they have become, because they became big at Christmas time, they have sort of absorbed a bit of Christmas in them, even though the song itself has zero to do with Christmas. You know, there's that sort of Christmas adjacent, which I get. I actually have albums that I love that I think I got at Christmas time. They probably were Christmas presents that I very much associate with Christmas because I was playing them and the lights were still up and the tree was there. And so, yeah, there's this music that is, maybe that's another topic for you to do, is non-Christmas music that has, because it came out at that time or is associated with something of that time, it has become Christmas music in a way, even though there's no Santa, no Jesus, no Frosty and all that stuff.
Right. You know, one of the things I think interesting about when I hear the foreign stuff is what it does make clear to you makes clear to me is that how much of what we associate with Christmas is entirely a function of, to a great degree, the time period that you have focused your collection on. And
right. Oh, yeah.
That, you know, it's not that they're, you know, we think of sleigh bells because producers and arrangers in the 40s and 50s and 60s put sleigh bells on all the Christmas songs.
Right.
And, you know, it's not intrinsic So anyway, it kind of, for me, I find it interesting because while on one hand it doesn't sound like I think like Christmas music, I'm used to Christmas music sounding.
Right.
It gives me a good reason to sort of interrogate it and decide what's there. And I had the same thing keeping track of current Christmas music because a lot of current Christmas music doesn't sound like music from the 50s or 60s.
Yeah, I don't want to say completely given up on current Christmas music, but I think it's mental bandwidth. I've sort of gone on a life cleanse recently. So the decluttering like physically, but also mentally.
Yeah.
You know, and I have lots of sort of projects, you know, I'm a bit of a dilettante. I'm into lots of different things and I kind of am wanting to focus myself a little more and not stretch myself out so thin and keeping up with, you know, the flood of information that we have in our lives everywhere is overwhelming. And so in the Christmas world and my friend Stubby is the man who keeps up on the new Christmas stuff. And he posts in the Fa-la-la-la-la forums. He used to have his own site, which went down a while ago, but he still is keeping it up in the forums at, you know, Fa-la-la-la-la. And I can't read all the posts. It just overwhelms me. And I'm not that interested in a lot of it. You know, there's some sort of contemporary Christian stuff, which, you know, I don't really care about. There's some alt folk stuff, you know, again, which it's great that it's out there and that there is this dynamic Christmas music scene and world for people who are hungry for that now. But it just to me is like a flood washing over me that I feel like I'm drowning.
Sure.
And so I kind of, you know, I have, you know, I forget, you know, 7,000-8,000 Christmas albums in my collection. I still have not heard all of them.
Wow. Yeah.
You know, and so it's like, and then I have the ones that I love that I want to listen to over and over again. So it's like, I feel like my buffet is full and, you know, and another dish. I just don't, I got to find a mental and physical place for it.
Yeah.
And so I kind of have backed off. And so I'm sort of backing off in a lot of ways. And so the blog, it's technically down. There's been a technical issue at my host and it's technically not there. And I was going to try and get it back working so I could archive everything. But I may not even do that. This may be like an actual purging. Like I think I have some of the databases, you know, maybe not super up to date. I may be missing a handful of things, but it's like, you know, do I need to hang on to that? Where am I going to keep it? You know? And so I may just let it go, but the forums will remain because it's still active. And there's not a whole lot of people, but there's a very active crew of people. And it's a group that I've been friends of mine for, again, almost 20 years now. And so that will remain, but I think the blog front of it will probably just kind of go away.
Yeah.
Which I'm okay with.
Yeah. It's interesting. I've got a wall of CDs from years of working and I finally decided I need to have less. I need to be able to sort of get all CDs onto one set of shelves and going through and finding things like CDs that collected old blues musicians that I've never actually been that fascinated with, but I always kind of thought there may come a day where I'm going to really want this. And so I've had it. And then, you know, with streaming, that stuff is all still available. There's someone's got the best, the essential. Everybody is in the galaxy.
Yeah.
And so I was like, I don't need to keep keeping this stuff.
We have an embarrassment of riches, which is, I mean, what a time to love music is, you know, that you can call up at any given second, almost anything. I was going to say, but there's still stuff that hasn't made it there. And so I have, you know, and again, I don't do CDs any, all my CDs are in the garage, you know, I'll rip something and I have a home server, a Plex server that has all my stuff on it, which I have an app that I can access from anywhere. So I can stream my home music no matter where I am, which is awesome. And so if I, you know, blah, 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 it's not on Spotify, oh, go to my home server and you know, there it is. And like, and so I have still that streaming access to all that stuff that I make sure I have backed up because, you know, if the drive goes, I want to make sure, you know, a lot of them I've gotten rid of the vinyl. I don't even have, so things that I've ripped, I don't have the vinyl anymore. So, you know, I got to make sure. And the CDs, most of the CDs I still have, especially like the rare stuff, the rare CDs. But, you know, most of the mainstream stuff, again, it's there. It's, you know, it's out there in the world. I don't need to hang on to it physically.
As we started talking about this and thinking about the idea of everything being out there, it made me think about the early to mid 90s. And the period when CDs and the record companies started to realize how much money there was in reissuing and re-releasing music that they had already paid for, that the sessions were done. And so they could just go back and repackage this material, repackage theoretically lost material, get it out, get it to new audiences. And that's kind of where we go today, because we are talking about the sort of the Ultra Lounge series that Capitol Records released, where they basically had, I believe it's producer Brad Benedict, there may be other producers in there, go in and curate this collection of lounge, exotica, hi-fi music from the Capitol Archives. And among those were two discs that I think had a huge impact on Christmas, on sort of a generation of Christmas music aficionados, Christmas Cocktails.
Absolutely.
So last time we talked, you told me the story of being sent the sort of the whole run of the Christmas Cocktail, of the Ultra Lounge series.
Yeah.
Start off, what was the appeal?
That's a memorable story, right?
So what was the appeal of that material to you at the time?
So I was born in 1965. So I mean, there's some generational stuff here and nostalgia. And so I think there, and so growing up, so my background musically, my parents didn't listen to music a lot. Neither one of them were musical at all, which is weird because I'm obsessed. But my dad was a theater guy, directed musicals. And so Broadway, you know, classic, you know, Broadway musicals, American theater, that music is in my blood. So the, you know, the standards, Rodgers and Hammerstein and, you know, all that stuff. So that sort of show music, was a big part of my life. And I think, again, as part of Gen X, there was, you know, movies on, you know, UHF stations on the weekends, you know, cheap, that the little local, you know, stations had, and you would watch these old kind of swinging movies of, you know, the 50s and 60s, and, you know, Jerry Lewis and Dean Martin, and you know, just all these kind of things. Something, I don't know why I had an affinity for that stuff. You know, it was the, you know, I'm a fan of that sort of design aesthetic, the, like the magazine and the graphic design of the 50s and 60s, the architecture. You know, I had an Atomic Ranch house, and, you know, I'm not like an entirely retro people who wear the clothes all the time and like live in that era, but there's something about it that definitely pulls me in. And yeah, so something about the cheesiness of it's cheesy, you know, the lounge and exotica stuff. There's this innocence about it this just kind of goofy, golly gee, but also a little, you know, dangerous, the Vegas, you know, kind of, there's a darkness underneath it too, that just is really interesting. And so I think I bought one, I think I found a CD shop, I don't remember the name of it, but the one Ultra Lounge one I got was the French music, you know, the accordion stuff, that sort of French, a lot of the French cafe sort of, that I just thought was so fun. And I got that disc, and I mentioned it in this one music list that I was on, an email list. Again, this was pre, internet forum days. This was email. And I mentioned, oh, I really love this. And one of the women who was on the group, I don't know if she asked me for my address. Like, she didn't tell me what was going on. I think she may have said, oh, you know. And she worked in the distribution office Capitol Records, specifically sending out samples for reviews. Wow. So, I mean, she did this all the time, would send out, you know, discs to people for, you know, promo stuff and radio stations. And so at one point I went to my mailbox and there was a box of like 18 CDs. She sent me the entire Ultra Lounge collection so all those collections. And then there was a bunch of there was a Jackie Gleason collection, a Martin Denny. There's a few of those like double disc sets. And so she sent me everything they had. And I'm just like, which I have all of those. Again, I've gotten rid of a lot of the CDs over the years, but I still have the entire Ultra Lounge collection. And so I sort of absorbed the whole thing. And so it wasn't specifically attached to Christmas at first. And so I think, and I'm not an all year round Christmas person. So, and I don't remember when I got these. So if I got them in April, I didn't listen to the Christmas stuff until it was Christmas time, you know, cause that's, and I don't remember at the time my reaction to them specifically. But there wasn't anything else like that at the time. You know, CDs were coming out, and I would buy Christmas CDs and, you know, would go through some of the obvious things, you know, the Bing, the Dean Martin. I still had an affinity for that sort of stuff, the loungy feel to things. So I was, you know, getting some of that stuff, and it was coming out at the time. But I know that nothing sounded like these collections. And so I will say one of the first things that probably pulled me in was the presence of the Holly Ridge Strings stuff, the two Holly Ridge Strings tracks. It's actually a medley. They sort of fade them into each other, because one of the four or five Christmas albums I had a kid was that Holly Ridge Strings record. And it was like one of my favorites. And those arrangements are, and there is not another Christmas album that sounds like that. So the Holly Ridge Strings, that wasn't available on CD. I think I still have my vinyl. And I think that actually pushed me to take that. I sent my vinyl of that record to a friend who was an audio engineer who had access, who could record vinyl onto MP3, which at that time, again, we're talking 96, 97, was not something every computer could do. It was still a pretty rare thing. I sent him that album and another Christmas album I had, and he recorded them and sent them back to me. So I had them on CDs. And I can't remember if that preceded the Ultra Lounge. I think it may have come after, like after I got these and I had a taste of the Holly Ridge Strings on, you know, digital. I was like, oh, I want to get that album so I can listen to it.
Yeah.
And so I think the Holly Ridge Strings pulled me in.
What was the contemporary music you were listening to at the time?
96, 97. I think I was heavily power pop.
Okay.
was I went through a power pop phase in the 90s, early to mid 90s, even into that period too. The sort of power pop revival,
okay,
you know, the 90s stuff. Jellyfish was sort of the hub of everything there. And the people who were doing that stuff, you know, XTC was going power pop and stuff. So very melodic, with interesting arrangements, diverse instrumental palettes, you know, which I found it, well, it for me. So even like the power pop stuff, like two guitar bass drums, okay, but give me stuff with some orchestra or weird, you know, or even some synths here or there, and just, you know, give me lots of colors, lots of stuff going on,
yeah,
you know, I think. And so I think the Lounge and Exotica stuff had that sort of almost psychedelic, right?
Yeah.
You know, so there was traditional instrumentation, but then here's some world instruments and some other stuff that are pulled in that give it a different feel from, you know, traditional, let's say, rock and roll or you know, Western pop music, you know, this mixing of elements that is really kind of cool. And so that's where I was, I think, musically at that point.
Yeah. You know, these came out to some extent to capitalize on what at the time was called a lounge revival. And I'm in New Orleans, and none of it touched here. And so, I mean, so really, at the time, aside from like the only band, current band I was aware of was Combustible Edison. And if they came to New Orleans, I missed it.
Sure.
And I was kind
Pink
of...
Pink Martini, maybe.
Pink Martini, but they also never came my direction. They were the same time. Right, right. They were the right time. But it all kind of, from where I was, it felt distant, bordering on a media creation. You were on the coast. How did you experience it?
No, I was on the East Coast. I was living. I grew up in Philly.
Okay.
And I lived in Philly and Boston, mostly Philly for most of my life. But I moved out of Philly in 1997 and into this actually a small town in central Pennsylvania, tiny little college town. So I was very isolated once into like 97, but in the early to mid 90s in Philly, I think I was around some of that more. And the building of some of that Exotica stuff. I don't remember seeing acts. One of the other places it also overlapped was there was an overlap between like the sort of traditional lounge revival Exotica and electronica bands like Air and who's the band? Emperor Tomato Ketchup.
Stereolab.
That's the album.
Stereolab, yeah.
Yeah, Stereolab, you know, sampling. They did a lot of bands are sort of sampling the Exotica stuff, or even the ones who weren't doing that may have borrowed some of the rhythmic elements and some of the different stuff. And so that was an interesting cross-pollination that I think I was interested in too. You know, I was always into electronic stuff. Synth pop and Berlin School, you know, Tangerine Dream and all that stuff. So electronic stuff was interesting to me and still is. And so that crossover was fresh and interesting at the time, which I think probably I was interested in too. You know, the grunge thing, I had periods of my life where I was into sort of heavy music, but as I got older, much less.
Sure.
You know, I love Nirvana. I mean, how could you not?
Right.
Because they're a perfect pop band. But so much of the other stuff that was going on mid-90s, I didn't care. Alice in Chains, you know, Pearl Jam. They were all right. They were decent. Yeah. I didn't dislike them, but it wasn't my... But so other things coming up. So again, the power pop thing was coming up. And the electronica, Exotica overlap was some cool stuff. And so I think some of that was bubbling in too. And there's a crossover even between some of the power pop and that electronica stuff. You know, Jason Faulkner from Jellyfish played with Air. Roger Manning from Jellyfish played with Air and Beck and all that stuff. So there's, yeah, this neat mixing of genres and influences, you know.
I was thinking when I was re-looking back and re-listening to the Christmas cocktails that the first one starts so great with Billy May doing Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer Mambo.
Basher, Dancer, Blancer, Vixen, Mush!
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That it's what, you know, this was back in the days before playlists, right, where sequencing was... You know, the order that you put things in on a record meant something, and you created a sense of motion and whatnot. And so putting that at the start was just brilliant to say, here's who we are. You're announcing, this is what we're about. Get ready to sit for this journey because we're going to rock your world with things you didn't know about.
Yeah, I agree. I hadn't even thought about that, about the... You know, in the days of, you know, days before playlists, where a compilation and a song list was actually deliberate.
Well, and you bought a CD, you opened it up, you popped it in the player. What's the first, you know, what's the first experience when that sound opens up? And that tune, just for, you know, the Ultra Lounge, the Christmas stuff, it just does it. It opens it right up.
Yeah. And I have to say, for me as somebody who is casually, I mean, I was casually interested in sort of crooners and lounge singers that, you know, I liked Louis Prima. I liked the others. I mean, I liked Sinatra and Dean and Sammy Davis Jr. more as icons than for the music. The best song still caught me. But I loved that this started with a kind of, it almost sounded like the lounge version of Dee Dee Ramone counting in a Ramone song.
Right. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah, exactly. So you right off the bat had a kind of an energy and a reverence that I immediately recognized as stuff that I valued transposed into another musical world.
Right.
And then to take a familiar song, Rudolph, and remake it as a mambo, also, again, kind of felt, first off, transformational, which where I'm dealing with covers is always important and valuable.
Oh, yeah.
But it also felt like it was moving it into an interesting place. Mm-hmm. And one in not entirely respectful of where it started. The idea of taking a song that was meant by Gene Autry to be, here's a song to sing, and it's like, no, now it's a dance song, and a mambo is a hips oriented dance song. So now we're even going to make Christmas a little bit sexy, and with any kind of luck, maybe a little bit sleazy, and all that vibe felt really valuable, and it suggested to me we're getting into a Christmas musical world here that I'm open to, and that I kind of kept hoping to find.
Well, that idea of transformation really is key to, I think, my interest also in Christmas music. I don't know that everybody has that, but I've made this comparison with other people, is I think it's similar to jazz in that there are standards, right? There are songs that, you know, you're going to hear and you're going to play over and over again, but each, you know, ensemble or person that plays it, they're going to put a different spin on it. And so you have something that is familiar. You're starting with this familiar bass, but what is this version going to do to it? Where is it going to take it that's going to make it new, but still keep that original bass. So there's a great combination of familiarity and novelty. And, you know, I think almost all Christmas music straddles that line, and they do it in different, you know, some lean more towards the, you know, the comfort, some lean more towards the experimentation. But that whole, you know, continuum is interesting. And so it's great to hear, you know, I don't know in my collection how many versions of Rudolph I have, you know, it's in the thousands, I'm sure. And it's interesting to hear, well, what's this person going to do to it? What's new? But what also keeps enough that I still feel like it's the core is there, that, and, you know, how far from the core do you go? And then how do you pull back, and what's there that, you know, just keeps your interest? And yeah, this definitely, again, another great way to start off is, you know, starting off with a familiar tune, you know, which most of them are. I'm trying to think, are there any really original? There's some, yeah, definitely some lesser known ones on here, you know, or ones that even weren't very well known or originals. You got what, Christmas Trumpets, I'd Like You for Christmas, Holiday on Skis. You know, some of them are not well known at all, but, you know, if you're going to start, you know, start with Jingle Bells, start with Rudolph, start with, you know, White Christmas or something, one of the biggies. So that familiarity is there. But yeah, this one is like, okay, but we're doing it different.
Right. Yeah. Did you have an immediate favorite on the record?
I think the Eddie Dunstetter jumped at me.
That's where I was going to go too. I saw Mommy Kissing Santa Claus, and that also segues into a Jingle Bells Bossa Nova.
That I think that made me want to go and find, and I think one of the reasons we're talking about this album is it did spur a lot of Christmas collecting and music. I think in that late 90s, I think a lot of the people I talked to who've gotten into this hobby, it was this collection kind of, you know, started ripples. And so that got me interested in that album, Christmas Candy by Dunstetter, which I think I found very soon after that. I'm just like, this is awesome. That again stands out as one of those records. There's a lot of Christmas organ and chimes records, and most of them are beyond crap. Or they all sound the same, you know.
Yes.
It's a little guy at a Hammond organ, you know. Or it's a very, you know, sort of religious, you know, at a church organ. But this is one of the hippest organ Christmas records. And it's just so good. I'm trying to remember if it's Jim Hall who plays guitar on this. I can't remember if it is or not. But it, yeah, that is, so I think those tunes jumped out to me.
Yeah. I have to say Eddie Dunstetter for me was huge because in part it was a name that I didn't know at that point.
Right.
And
right.
So to have a fresh name on the plate was useful. Mm-hmm. And it really is an oddly distinctive organ sound. It is not like a Jimmy Smith and someone who's just rocking the B3. And it's not a church organ.
No.
It's a very thick roller rink organ. And again, for me, moving Christmas to the roller rink, I'm there for that.
It's also a really warm organ sound. Again, some of the organs can just really, like I said, some of those B3s can be really cutting and kind of sharp. This is, and again, I think it gets back to what you were talking about before about being sexy. I don't know if a lot of people would listen to this now and call it sexy, but there's a certain sort of, you know, there's that gentle groove to some of the tunes, but then, and again, to me, the warmth of that organ sound sort of is inviting.
Yeah,
in a way that I like a lot. I don't remember sort of looking to see what like some of the sales numbers were for some of these tunes. And so I imagine some of them weren't on the major cultural radar. I mean, again, you have some of the big acts on here, Peggy Lee and, you know, the Crooners, like you say, and those ones, you know, definitely made their way into like mainstream. But I have a feeling a lot of it was, you know, hipster sort of record collectors or someone who, you know, people who bought things would have some of these, but it wasn't every mom and pop, you know, kids growing up with this as their Christmas record, or not a whole lot. And again, I don't have data to support that, but that's sort of my take. But, you know, there was definitely, you know, late 50s, early 60s, you know, I guess from 57 into, like, I don't know, 62, 63, you know, that lounge exotica, those, you know, dances, the mambo, the samba, the mambo, the samba, the cha-cha, you know, people were taking dance classes and learning those things and doing those dances. So it was also a mass culture thing. So the novelty of someone saying, hey, let's make this tune a cha-cha and get people to buy these records, you know, yeah, that was going on, I imagine.
Yeah, you realize it was, at the time, it was likely people kind of pawing at the newer, larger world. Mm-hmm. And that it wasn't that, you know, it was a first attempt at being a little more international, a little more cultured, right, a little more sort of plugged into your moment. But I think it's one of the things really interesting about this collection is how much of this not only sounded new in the 90s when mm-hmm. it came out. I mean, when this came out, I remembered hearing the Holly Ridge Strings. I'm not sure if I'd heard these songs, but I recognized the Holly Ridge Strings from my dad, the easy listening station my dad used to listen to while he was mm-hmm. working.
Well, they they did bunches of records of lots of mainstream acts. Like, they have collections of Beatles songs, Simon and Garfunkel, Elvis Presley, Beach Boys. I think those were, so all the Holly Ridge String stuff was late 60s sort of pop covers, you know, by Strings, drenched in reverb. Oh my God, like in a cavern. Yeah, those records, I feel like I'm soaking wet every time I listen to those. It's just, which again, I love. I love that sort of weird spaciousness. But,
you know, I had to say I knew Christmas Kisses by Ray Anthony. The one I don't know if I knew, but I love on here, and someone I have come to love is Peggy Lee and her version of Winter Wonderland.
Sleigh bells ring. In the lane, snow is glistening, a beautiful sight. We're happy tonight, walking in a winter wonderland.
This probably made me start falling in love with Peggy Lee again. So I mean, I was getting into collecting Christmas music at this time, but I was also into collecting lots of lounge and exotica too. So I would get Peggy Lee's Christmas Carousel, which is, again, a hugely underrated Christmas album. And I think it's almost, if not entirely, all originals.
It is.
And I think she either wrote or co-wrote most of them, too.
Yes.
So it's just stellar. But I started collecting some of her, you know, more mainstream stuff. And, you know, her voice, I love Peggy Lee. Yeah, she's just amazing.
Yeah, I knew I liked... She was interesting, and much like a lot of the people who I run across while doing this show and collecting Christmas music, I now have more to go with for a lot of people my connection to them was through TV talk shows. Because I remember that I would see Peggy Lee would be on Mike Douglas mm-hmm. or on Johnny Carson. And so
Dinah Shore.
Yeah. So there were a lot of people, and I didn't really know what they were famous for. And mm-hmm. usually by the time they were there, the mm-hmm. moment that had made them had passed.
Right.
And so so for me, she was just kind of a TV talk show, variety show staple. And to actually have time to mm-hmm. interact with just her as a musician
well that's yeah
was really I, useful
I think, I think were, I guess, from the same or similar generation. I think of that those same things. And so it was interesting then to later go back, you know, speaking of those talk shows, to listen to Dinah Shore albums and Mike Douglas albums where they are singers.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, oh, wait. Didn't they just, you know, sit and interview people on TV? No, they, you know, they had these, those careers. Well, just like today. I mean, look at, you know, Kelly Clarkson.
Yeah.
You know, it is the host. And I mean, yeah, she's had hits probably more recently in some ways, but it's not dissimilar, which is kind of fascinating.
Yeah. I found a few years ago, when we're finished, I'll send you a link to this, but I interviewed Peggy Lee's granddaughter.
Okay.
Who is also the musical executor of her estate. At one point when they were putting out a collection of her Christmas music, that I got a chance to talk to her about Peggy Lee. Mm-hmm. And she had tipped me to the fact that Peggy Lee had written everything or co-wrote everything on Christmas Carousel. And, you know, but it's such a heartbreaking story when you think about it, because it was so hard for her to be taken seriously.
Absolutely.
You know, in her mind. And when you hear it now, it is clearly she's a singer that in Sinatra's class.
Oh, absolutely.
But at the time, there was just no accepting the premise that a woman was in like that top three, top five. No,
I definitely think of her as on that level. And the same, you know, with Sammy Davis Jr. I mean, Sammy Davis Jr. run rings around Sinatra in terms of talent. And, you know, he played drums, he played vibraphone, played trumpet, was a dancer. My God, I mean, you watch Sammy Davis Jr. and he just was in a different universe in some ways, and completely underappreciated. And I wish he had more Christmas music too. I mean,
me too.
We have a few tunes of his, you know, but he's one that's like, oh, to hear him do some more of that, you know, again, from maybe like 1960, 1961, and that, oh man, that would be, you know. Luckily, there were some other people who went back and did stuff. Another person I think who was fairly underrated at the time, and actually my favorite crooner, male crooner, let's say, of all time, is Mel Torme. And, you know, he had a couple little Christmas tunes, but he put out a Christmas album. I think it was 1989, his actual.
Oh, wow.
I forget, something like that. And again, it's actually a great album. It's great stuff. But I would have killed to have him like do stuff in his prime.
Yeah. 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 I got to say, I also would love to have heard a Sammy Davis Jr. Christmas record from the 70s. Same time around the time he's doing the theme to Beretta, and hear him be slightly funkier as well. That'd be awesome. I would take that.
Yeah. No, that would be fun.
So I have to say, we've talked about the sort of Rat Pack, talked around. I have to say, a track that now doesn't age well is on the second Christmas Cocktails, that there's Dean Martin's version of Baby It's Cold Outside.
Yeah.
And I have to say, that for a long time, I mean, I still love Dean because I love how there is a deceptive ease to everything he does.
Sure.
And how upfront he was about the image. I want to say it's Winter Romance, his first Christmas album. And the cover has Dean and a woman on the ski slopes.
Yeah.
And the woman is like so happy to be with him, and he's smiling. But you can also see over her shoulder that she can't see is another woman smiling at Dean. And you realize that's who he's really looking at.
Right.
And to add to the whole funkiness of it, it really looks like that picture already existed, or that drawing already existed, and that they took the original guy's face out and put in a drawing of Dean on top of it. And
I'll
so
have to look
it's
at that more
slightly
closely.
Awkward. The body parts don't all line up exactly right. And so it's like, it's a natural, it's kind of leering, and it's very cad, and it's also a little bit two-bit. And his performances are such, it sounds like he really can't take any of these songs or Christmas seriously. And that's sort of on brand.
Well, if you get to watch his Christmas specials, which a bunch of them are on YouTube, they're just a whole lot of fun. But yeah, there is this sense where he's winking and, you know, just and in his brain cashing the check while he's doing it. You could just see him like, okay, yeah, you know, this is gonna do me all right. I can sort of appreciate the it's pretty clear that's what he's doing. He's not, you don't see a lot of insincerity in him sort of fawning all over like what Christmas means to me and how important it is in my family. You know, I'm trying to remember if he says any of that. I don't remember, but that's not the overwhelming impression where he's, you know, trying to sell that kind of down home family Christmas. He's just like, hey, this is me and I'm gonna, you know.
Yeah.
Baby It's Cold Outside sort of is the, you know, the clearest iteration of that in a lot of ways. And yes, it has become, you know, now sort of referred to as the date rape song.
I really can't
but
stay.
Baby, it's cold outside.
Got to go
but
away.
Baby, it's cold outside.
This evening has
been hoping that you drop
so
in.
Very nice.
I'll hold your hands, they're just like
my
ice.
Mother will start to
beautiful. What's
I find. I read an interesting argument that basically contended that this whole conversation was essentially the woman saying the things she had to say
right
in the culture at the moment to be able to sort of lay down a pretext for
right.
enjoying maintain, and indulging
right. women right.
her
women,
own,
you're
her
not,
own
you're not
libido.
Allowed. You're not allowed to enjoy sexuality. That's not what's expected of you. Save it for marriage, you know, blah, blah, blah. And yeah, so, yes, I've seen some arguments about that it is, you know, like feminist and empowering, you know, for that time that she's taking what she wants, right? It isn't
right,
just
yeah.
about what he wants. It's also what she wants, but she has to, unfortunately, to, you know, maintain the reputation. She has to look coy. She has to, you know. But I appreciate that in recent years that the song has opened up this conversation to
sure.
make us think of it, you know, to see like, okay, well, what is happening here? And, you know, was that acceptable at the time? And how do we feel about it differently? You know, and again, I'm saying this as a male and so I know my perspective, you know, isn't, or shouldn't be the only one for darn sure.
Well,
but
and I was going to say, and the thing about this one, which for me is harder to get to, I've got a lot of, I say my threshold is, mm-hmm. I've never loved the song. So it's not like, not like 86ing it is hard for
right.
me.
Right.
There are versions I'm more entertained by than others.
Sure.
And I can hear the argument and I'm interested in it. At the same time, in this case, having him sing the male parts and having like 20 women.
Right.
Backing as singing
right.
all singing the girl parts together, mm-hmm. that feels fishy. That feels right. very, a little too much like
but
we're
again,
putting it, together it, all the women who've in one song, and like that doesn't wear well for me.
But again, some of that could come down to pragmatics. It was probably cheaper for them to pay his backup singers, the Gold Diggers, than to get in Peggy Lee or, you know, someone with a name that they then have to pay. It's like, all right, we're already paying the Gold Diggers. Just have him come and sing on the background, you know?
I'm sure 100%. And that
right.
And that there was nobody they were going to bring in who was going to sell any more copies than Dean was. If Dean's name wasn't going to sell it, no one else was going to change anything on it.
Mr. Kringle is soon gonna jingle the bells that'll tingle all your troubles away. Everybody's waiting for the man with a bag, 'cause Christmas is coming again. He's got a sleigh full.
What I think became the standout track from the first one that breathed new life into it that was not a standard at the time is Everybody's Waiting for the Man with the Bag.
Yes.
I think when this collection came out, that was not well known in the general culture. You wouldn't, you know, some stations that started playing 24-hour Christmas, they may have played it, but not prominently enough that you're like, oh, there's that song, you know?
Right.
They need to fill hours and hours, and they had old Christmas albums. Like, okay, let's pop this out. But since then, that song has become, you know, covered by everybody and everybody. And, you know, you hear it now in the background of Christmas episodes of TV shows or movies. And, you know, it has, I think, become sort of a Christmas standard in retrospect.
Yeah. It's K-Star, who was yet another, you know, she sang, I can't remember who her band leader was. A lot of these cases, a lot of these vocalists started off as the singers with dance bands and with big bands, and they eventually developed their careers on their own. I'm 90% sure that's her story. And yeah, this is one of the songs that immediately jumped off this thing for me. And part of the reason I wanted to talk to you is because I realized, having watched these songs sort of slowly enter the culture, it's that I wasn't alone in responding to these songs. And I've now heard Man with the Bag. I've heard it while buying groceries during the holiday season.
Yeah.
And occasionally we'll hear it in the different sort of, with stations go all Christmas, that some stations will fold that in too. And and it was and I don't think anything else has had the same kind of life.
Right. Any of the sort of lesser known tunes, like I said, you know, like you said, you know, Christmas Trumpets or none of the others. Well, a bunch of those also are, I think, the instrumentals are less likely to sort of take off. So Christmas Trumpets or Holiday on Skis, you know, they're kind of great. But if you take them out of the context of playing them in Christmas records, no one would know that they were Christmas tunes necessarily.
Sure. You know?
And so I think that's really, of all of these, Christmas Kisses, I guess, is the other one that is a sort of vocal record, but that isn't a song that's a classic song already. And that one just didn't, you know, that one certainly hasn't become as embedded as The Man with the Bag.
No.
And I guess that one as a song feels more novelty-like. The Waiting for the Man with the Bag is just a classic big band, you know, arrangement. It just sort of, you know, the horns are great. It comes out. It's got a lot of energy. And so it just sounds like a big old-fashioned big band record. And so
it swings really hard.
Yeah. And Christmas Kisses is just kind of, it's cute, you know? And so if I heard Christmas Kisses outside of this, again, collection, would it jump out? I don't know. And so again, the curation of these collections is really interesting, and that a song like that can shine maybe a little bit more when it's put in with these others, you know? And when I put these discs on now, I love listening to them like start to finish.
Right.
They create, so again, it's almost like, you know, the old albums of our youth, you know, you put it on and you listen to it all the way through. And so the way they curated the playlists, they're just, it's great. It'll go from upbeat numbers to ones that are a little more sort of laid back and, you know, bachelor pad late night, you know, sort of smoky stuff, that just creates a great overall mood. You know, you're feeling like, hey, it's 1959, 1961. I'm relaxing by my little bar here in the house. I have a cocktail, and you know, this is what I'm listening to. And
the one thing I find along those lines that I really appreciate about this is that as much as this is about a specific period of time, that I don't feel like I'm being asked to love that time.
Sure.
That it's not, hey, let's all join in a sort of a kumbaya love-in for this beautiful time gone by.
Right.
That the songs give you a reason to care about themselves. And from there, you will or won't find your, you know, whatever your nostalgia is. But they, you know, because I'm really suspect of nostalgia, and mm-hmm. I'm not a very nostalgic person, and particularly when I'm often presented a package of material from a given period of time, I'm always, my sort of radar goes off as I'm sort of trying to make sure that I'm not being asked to fetishize a moment, fetishize a time. And the songs have such a life of their own mm-hmm. that, yeah, that time, that life comes from somewhere, and that sound comes from somewhere. And you can't right. deny that, but you don't have to love 1959, 1960 sure. to love yeah. this. If anything, the song gives you songs give you a reason to go back and rethink about
right
that time. Yeah.
Santa can keep the hi-fi set. There's something that is better yet. I want your Christmas kisses.
And I think we've talked about this before, and I have said that I'm a much more nostalgic person. I think we got into that. I definitely feel that, but it is a complex. It isn't like I just want to live in 1959. But there are people like that. You know, I know people who, you know, the women still are wearing poodle skirts, and they do their house. Like, you know, they get an old ranch house and they do it exactly. You know. Exactly in that period, which, okay, you know, I can see that in a way. But to me, it's a thread that can be woven through a lot of different things. So, if we're going back to that time period, it's, over 60 years ago now at this point. And so you can sort of hear, like, let's say these tunes, and it can hop you back immediately to that point. Or these are part of a history and you can weave through them. And so, and again, for me now, and it's, we're talking what, almost 30 years later after these, right?
Yeah.
That these can hop me back to boom, that period when I got these, which then sort of references in some ways back to the 1970s when I was a kid, some of the Hollywood Strings and those things when I was listening to Christmas music, which was before I was born. But those threads sort of allow me to sort of time travel and hop around. And so it's not just inhabiting that, going from this place to that place, but it's navigating a sort of complex history, both personal and cultural. Right.
Yeah.
So that, these things are representations of, because we're talking about things like, gender roles and, all that kind of stuff that are part of social stuff, but also each of our own individual experiences of these holidays in our family when we were young or old, what did we remember and recall and take with us? And so the nostalgia is very multifaceted and kaleidoscopic in a way
mm-hmm.
And even in there, I sort of skip past when I was playing this kind of stuff around my house when my kids were little. And so there's a nostalgia even for my, the next generation of my family. So there's all those things in there for me.
Thanks to Brad Ross-MacLeod for the time and the talk. You can find him at fireside.falalalala5laws.com and join the conversation. You can find me on Facebook, 12 Songs of Christmas. If anybody knows Brad Benedict or knows how to get a hold of him, please let him know that I'd love to have him on the show. We'll finish with one from the Wonderland series. From Yulesville, this is a version of The Christmas Song by Sergio Mendez and Brazil 66. I love this, and I'll talk to you next week.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire. Jack Frost nipping at your nose. Yuletide carols. being sung by a choir and folks dressed up like Eskimos.